Hi friends, welcome to the video lectures of object oriented programming. I hope you've gone through the previous lectures of object oriented programming. There we have covered the types of inheritance and what are the visibility and access modifiers available in inheritance. So in today's lecture we will see the virtual functions, pure virtual functions and abstract classes. So these three terms are related with each other. Now, when we see the virtual function, so it is also called as the runtime binding, or it is also called the example of runtime binding. Now, what we'll see the binding? The binding is nothing but the refers to the data member or member function to the object. That means the object is linked with the data member and member function. That linking takes place either is at a compile time or is at the runtime. So that defines the two ways, that is the binding is at the compile time is called as early binding, and the binding is at the runtime is called as late binding. So the example of late binding is virtual functions, and the example of early binding is the function overloading or operator overloading. Now, what do you mean by binding? Now, binding refers to the process of converting your identifiers like our member functions or data members into address. That means convert it into the address. Now, binding is done for every data member and member functions. Now, the matching of member functions to the procedure called, that means the function that we called from the main function, whether it matches to the function that is available in the class. That matching takes place either at the compile time or at the runtime. I hope you understand that in much more detail. Again, the early binding, when this is the early binding, so is it takes place at the time of compile. So when we compile the program, so at that time the linking or the binding takes place. So that is also called as the early binding. That means before execution this binding takes place. And when we say that the late binding, so the procedure called to the object, that linking takes place at the time of run or execution time, so that is called as the late binding. So at the name indicates late binding, that means the program is compiled already, and when we are going into the execution phase, at that time the object is linked to your function, that is called as the late binding. So best example for that is a virtual function. Now, when we say the virtual function, there are some terminologies, but before that we will see a simple program. Here we have a base class alpha contains one member function show. Again, we have the derived class which access the properties from the base class. So from base class to derived class we are inheriting the properties, and in the derived class also we are having the same function name as a show. So show function is available in the base class also and derived class also. Now, here in the main function, we are creating the object of derived class, that is beta is the derived class, so beta b. So b is the object of derived class. So we know very well the derived class object can access the properties of base class also and derived class also. That means it will execute the function from base class and derived class also. So when we write the b.show, so what do you think which function will call? Because show function is available in the base class also and it is available into the derived class also. So what do you think? So the answer is it will execute the show function from the derived class, from the derived class, because here the compiler gets into ambiguous state, but it decided into a single stage that the object is of which class. So basically this object is of derived class, so directly it will execute the member function from the derived class without any kind of the confusion. But when we have to execute the member function from the base class, so what we have to do at that time? So firstly we will execute this program. So same program I have created here, class base is there. For this lecture we have taken the Turbo C compiler. So base class is there, in that one member function show is there, In that one cout statement, this is base class, this is going to show, this is base class. Class derived is there, which is inheriting the properties from the base class, and which again having the show function, which displays one statement, this is a derived class. So here we have created the object of derived class, that is derived D. Derived D is there, and we have called here, here we have created the object of derived class, and we have called the d.show. So which show function it will execute, because show function is available in the base class and derived class. So let's check. So we'll get, this is a derived class. That means the show function executed from the derived class, because d is the object of derived class, right? Here again, one thing I have to tell you. When we compile the program, see here, the lines compiled are 1047. That means 1047 lines are compiled. But in our program, that is p1.cpp, I think only 22-23 lines are there. So from where we get these numbers, that lines compiled? So the answer is 1047. That is 1047 lines are available into our header file. Basically, we have included the two header files, that is iostream.h and conio.h. So when we compile our program, so all the lines which are available into iostream.h and conio.h, from these two files, all the lines are again compiled. So that's why we get the count there, 1047 lines. So fine. So the next thing is that the derived class object only execute the derived class object. Now the question is, how we can execute the base class member function? So again, we can forcefully call the member function from the scope resolution also we can forcefully execute the member function of base class. So like d dot, what we can say, the base class name is a base, and the scope resolution, which function we have to execute, show function. So that's it. So this line will execute show function from base class, and above is a show function from derived class. So let's check. So look at the output. Here we are getting that this is derived class and this is base class. So both the statements are executed. But this is not the problem where the virtual function exists. We have a different problem. For that, the virtual function comes to the rescue. We will see a simple scenario. For example, derived D object is there, and when we have base pointer PTR, or let's say when we have the pointer B object is there, and D object is of derived class, and if we put the address of D, that is B is equal to ampersand D, that means here we are going to store the address of derived class object into base class object. And we know if we have the pointer object, so how we call the member function? We call it by the arrow operator. So B arrow show. So which function will execute? Basically, B is the object of base class, D is the object of derived class. But we have put the address of derived class into base class. So in the B, we have the address of derived class, right? Now, B contains the address of derived class. So which function will it execute? By the syntactic way, it should execute the show function from the derived class, right? Because we have put at the address of derived class. So let's check the output. But we get the output from the base class. So how it is possible? That means we have stored the address of derived class, but it will not store the address of derived class. So what the problem is? Basically, again, it will see that the show function is available into the base class and same function is available into derived class. So without bothering or without going into the confusion state, the compiler takes which object the function is executing or which object is calling the function. Here the B, that is the base class, is calling the show function. So it is directly call the show function from the base class. If we write the D dot show, so that will execute the show function from the derived class. But this concept should be solved. So for that, virtual function comes to the rescue. Now we'll see in much more detail the virtual function. The virtual function is a member function which is declared within a base class, right? The function is also in the base class and redefined or overridden in a derived class. Why we have written as a overridden? Because same function name and same arguments are available into the derived class. So that's why we give a name as a overridden, not a overloading. There is a two difference between overloading and overriding is that in the overloading, function name is same and arguments are different, right? In the function overloading, function name is same and only arguments are different. But when we see the function overriding, in that case, function name is also same and arguments are also same. Now, the second point that we have covered that is related with the pointer. Now, virtual function ensure that the correct function is called for an object regardless of the type of reference. So basically, it says that the appropriate or the correct function should be called at the runtime. Now, there are mainly used to achieve runtime polymorphism. As we have seen in the previous slide, that is of two type, late and early time binding. So proper function should be called. Now, functions are declared with a virtual keyword in the base class. So what we will do, the function which is present into the base class, we precede the keyword virtual. That means, to solve this problem, basically here, the address of derived class should be stored into the base class and it should execute the show function from the derived class, but it is not going to do like this. So why? That I have told earlier that B is the object of base class, so it is directly execute the show function from the base class. So to remove such kind of problem, we apply the virtual keyword. Now what the virtual means? Virtual is nothing but just a virtual environment without existing physically. So we write a virtual keyword before the function name, okay, in the base class, but that is always into the base class function. So here we have the virtual keyword into the show function. So let's again execute the program. Now execute the program. Here we are getting the output as a, this is derived class. Now we are getting the correct output. This is derived class. That means B is going to store the address of derived class D, right? Previously it executed the show function from the base class, but here it is now going to store the address of derived class into the B class object, and now it is going to show the show function from the derived class, because here the compiler comes to know that virtual function is there. So that means two copies are available into the base class also and derived class also. So it will do the manipulation, that means copying the data from one object to another object, because it is not in confusion state. I think this function is cleared for you. Again, the resolving of function call is at the runtime. That means which function to call is decided at the time of runtime. Now there are some rules are there for the virtual function. Just keep it in mind. Virtual functions cannot be static. That means the virtual function that we have defined into the base class, that should not be any static function. That should not be any static function and cannot be a friend function. So your virtual function should not be your static function and not be your friend function. What is friend function? That we will see in upcoming lectures. Next point is, virtual function should be accessed using pointer or a reference of a base class type. So again, the pointer concept we will see into the lecture. The prototype of virtual function should be same in base as well as derived class. Prototype, that means the same syntax of the class name or the argument, that same structure should be present into the base class as well as into the derived class. Now, the virtual functions are always be defined into the base class. That means the functions which are available into base class are called as virtual functions, and which are overridden, that means same structure is available into derived class. Now, a class may have the virtual destructor, but it cannot have a virtual constructor. We will see into the next lecture where we will cover the constructor and destructor, that why it should not contain a virtual destructor, because that will not execute in anymore. Next is pure virtual function. But before starting with the pure virtual function, we will again go to the program and discuss some one two topics. That we can call the base class function forcefully with the help of scope resolution. But keep it in mind some points. We cannot create a pointer object of derived class, right? So here we have created the pointer object of a base class, but we cannot create the pointer object of a derived class. That will gives you the error. That means we cannot store the data from derived class to base class. Okay. So inversely inheritance is not possible when we create the pointer object. Now we will create the pointer object of base class and store the address of derived class. That is possible. That means we will create the pointer object of base class and we are going to store the address of derived class. That is possible. Okay, that we have seen right now. So only keep it in mind, we cannot create the object pointer object of derived class for that case. Okay. Now next is a pure virtual function. Pure virtual function is same as with the virtual function. That means why it is called as the pure virtual function. So in the pure virtual function, the name virtual function is common, right? So the function is available into the base class also and derived class also. Now what the pure is? Pure is nothing but the function is only declared into the base class and defined it into a derived class. That means in the base class, the function is only declared. The definition is not available into base class. So that's why the function should be like this, that virtual keyword is available, void return type, show function is never, right? But the body is not available, so we'll write there is equal to zero. That means the definition is empty. So this is the syntax of pure virtual function. That means the function is only declared into the base class. Now we'll go with the program again. So here the function is only declared because same function is available into base class and derived class. So is equal to zero. Function body is not there. Okay. Right, so only function is declared into the base class and defined, the same function is available into derived class. So that function is called as pure virtual function. So let's check the output. This is a derived class, as we have stored the address of derived class into base class. So it will execute the body of only a derived class because the function from the base class is only declared. No body is there, no definition is there. Okay, so this function is called as pure virtual function because that is a virtual function, but that is a pure virtual function. Why we called it as a pure? Because the only declaration is available, right? Second point is that we cannot create object of an abstract class. Now what is abstract class? So abstract class is that the class which contains at least one pure virtual function. That means the show function that we have created like this, so that is called as the pure virtual function. So the class which contains at least one pure virtual function is called as abstract class, is called as abstract class. So for this scenario, this class base contains, this base class contains one pure virtual function. So that's why this base class is called as abstract class. This is called as abstract class. Now this derived class is called as derived class as it is, no changes is available. Now the base class is always be a abstract class because that contains a at least one pure virtual function. So kam se kam isme ek to bhi pure virtual function chahiye, then and then we called it as a abstract class. Now how many pure virtual functions we can create? So the answer is number of pure virtual functions we can create. So like this, for example, if we have a second virtual function, that is virtual void, let's say display. Display is also a function. So again, the definition is not available, so that is only a declared. So that is also a pure virtual function. So how many pure virtual functions are there into the base class? Two are there. So like this number of functions we can create. Now into the derived class, we can define this display function. So just like void, in the derived class, we don't have to write the virtual, okay? So void display. Here we will write a cout statement that this is display function. Okay. Now display function will also be called just like this B. So we should get the output of both the functions. Right. So this is derived class and same this is display function. So both the functions are executed, and the notable thing is that both these functions are only declared. So only declared are there. So this is called as the pure virtual function, and the class which contains the pure virtual function is called as abstract class. If you have any kind of doubt, you can comment it below. Okay. So the class which contains at least one pure virtual function is called as abstract class. Got it? Same, the third topic is abstract class. So a class is an abstract class if it has at least one pure virtual function. So the abstract class can contains many number of pure virtual function. And the second thing is that we cannot create an object of abstract class, but we can create pointer object of an abstract class, right? Now, abstract class is a class which contains at least one pure virtual function. So, pure virtual function is available into our program. So, the statement says that we cannot create the object of abstract class, but we can create the pointer object of an abstract class. So, let's check. So, in this case, base is a class which contains pure virtual function. Our statement says that we cannot create an object of an abstract class, that is base class. So here we have created the object of base class, that is B, but that is a pointer object, right? So the statement says that we can create a pointer object, but you cannot create a normal object. So let's check. So base pointer B is a pointer object, we can create it, no problem, of abstract class. But when we say the object, that is B1 is the normal object, so that is not allowed. So shall we get the error at that time? So let's check. Yes, we are getting one error that cannot create an instance or an object of an abstract class base. That means we cannot create a normal object from an abstract class, but we can create a pointer object. Got it? So base B1, this is not possible because base is a abstract class, because that contains a pure virtual function. So we cannot create a normal object, but we can create a pointer object of an abstract class. I hope these things are going to be clear in your mind. So these are the three terms. Virtual functions, that means the function which is available into the base class, we apply the virtual keyword before that. Are you getting this thing? We are applying the keyword virtual to the function which is available into the base class. So both these functions may get executed. Second thing, pure virtual function. That means the function is only declared. Okay. So virtual void show is equal to zero. Is equal to zero means that function is only declared. We can write like this also, that virtual. Then as I am conducting from a mouse, so it becomes difficult right now. So void show, we can write like this also. Okay, no body is there, only declaration is there. Instead of is equal to zero, we can write like this also. That means we can create a parenthesis but no statement. So this syntax is also applicable. So the function is only declared into the base class and defined in derived class, that is called as pure virtual function. And the third is abstract class. It's a very simple. The class which contains at least one pure virtual function is called as abstract class. Now abstract class can contains number of pure virtual functions. Okay. Now, second point is that we cannot create an object that we have seen earlier. We cannot create a simple object of an abstract class, but we can create a pointer object. There are some kind of the characteristics of abstract class. I hope you've gone through this. You first execute some simple programs related with the virtual function, pure virtual function, and let's check the property of abstract class. So you will get very familiar with that. So abstract class cannot be instantiated. That means the object cannot be created, but pointers object we can create of an abstract class. Abstract class can have a normal functions and variables along with a pure virtual function. We can't justify whether it is an abstract class or not, but only by watching the pure virtual function we can say that is an abstract class. That means we don't have to write any abstract keyword. What is abstract class? In some of the students' mind, the confusion is that we have to write an abstract keyword in front of it, but that is not correct. Abstract is not a keyword, okay, for these terminologies. Whether if we have the pure virtual function available, then we call it as an abstract class. Abstract classes are mainly used for upcasting. That means the functions are only declared into base class and defined into derived class. So some kind of syntaxes we have used the abstract classes. The classes inheriting an abstract class must implement all pure virtual function. That means it is says that all the pure virtual functions should be defined into the derived class. Else they become an abstract too. Otherwise, the derived class will also become the abstract class if it does not execute that. Okay. Now, why we can't create the object of abstract class? Again, I am repeating, we can create the object of abstract class, but that is only a pointer object. Normal object we cannot create of an abstract class. Why? Now, there is another concept called as a V table, that is also called as virtual table. Now, when we write a virtual, when we write a pure virtual function, the compiler sees the word virtual. So when the compiler sees the keyword virtual, so all the functions which are present into base class, it does not allocate any kind of address. Okay, it reserves some space for the base class member functions, but it does not allocate any address. So this is kind of the address. This kind of allocation is not takes place when it sees the keyword virtual. So that's why we can't create the normal object of an abstract class. Okay. As the V table or the virtual table for abstract class is incomplete, as the addresses are not allocated, as the address is not allocation, whatever we store the value in these storage spaces will not get affected because that is totally incomplete. So for the abstract class, the reservation is available, reservation takes place, but the allocation will not applicable. Okay, so that's why when we create the object of abstract class, that is base B1, we get an error. Because why we get an error in that case? Because base is an abstract class and B1 is the object. Because for this B1, some space is reserved, but address is not allocated. The compiler can't see the address of B1, so that's why it gives you the error. But when we create a pointer object, so at that time it allocates some kind of the address. So let's see the structure of a virtual table. So for example, this is a virtual table structure. This is the object B1. Okay. So these are the object reservations for the base class. Okay. For the base class, and these are the reservations for the derived class. Okay. So when we have the virtual keyword, when the compiler sees the virtual keyword from the base class or the pure virtual function in the base class, so it allocates the reservations. Okay, reservations are allowed, no, not any issue, but it does not any kind of the address. So address jo milna chahiye wo address yahan pe nahi milta hai. So that's why when the object going to see this function, so that it can't see. Okay, so that's why we get an error for that. But pointer, when we create a pointer object, at that time the address is allocation. That is a simple topic of VPTR. Okay, I hope you gone from this all these concepts, that is virtual function, pure virtual function, and abstract classes. So that is the answer why we can't create the object of an abstract class. Okay, so I hope you gone through these topics and you learn very well. If you have any kind of doubt, you can comment below through this video. Okay, and kindly like and subscribe to this channel for the latest updates and notifications. Thank you.